Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We here at Tashua Community this Shabbat, we say to all of our listeners and our friends, we say Shabbat Shalom, greetings in the precious name of Yahshua HaMashiach. He is the Emat, the truth of Yah revealed to a nation, that his righteousness may be known unto his people, the elects of his bosom, those whose names are written in the mind of his HaMashiach. That's why he lost not one, except the one of perdition. You know that a man is of perdition when he hears Torah, and he constantly hardens his heart. There's a defiance of his nature that he resists Torah. He contemplates his own paths and he takes his own higher roads. Yet he negates to follow precisely by the Ruach of Yah, what he commands unto his nation, his people. There is only one Ichad, one Torah. For Yisrael, the Ger that dwells among that nation, just one Torah. There is only one way, not multiples. It's not the Baptist way, the white boy's way, the Negro way, the Jew way. It's Torah. It's the power of his government, his Mishra. Governs our minds to administer that which is righteously written from the Reshith, from the beginning. He didn't write anything that we are not obligated to fulfill. Every offering, everything he commands, we must do it. We must. Not only do we perform the letter, because Yahshua is the letter. And not only was the letter written and the letter came among us, but it was revealed by Ruach. It is letter and it is Ruach. It is Yah, his breath. He is breath. He is life. And where we negate to understand what Yah commands us is because there is a spirit among his nation that makes you forget, makes you deny, makes you offend him. There's a spirit, and we find fault with him. We know that because when we look upon each other, we do not make and assess the tzaddik or the righteous judgment. The Torah calls it a shame that we look at one another and then we find, it's easy, isn't it, to find the faults of others. Very easy, isn't it? I've had very few people to come to me and tell me their faults. I've counseled and talked to many wives and husbands over the years. And it's always the other one. It's never me. And when I sit them down together, I listen. And I can see the dominant one. And the more she talked, I said, that's the problem right there. It's just a fact. There's nothing more beautiful than a wife. There's nothing on the face of the earth that has the beauty of a wife. There is nothing more pronounced than the strength of a Geber, a warrior, that has given all and has given up all for the namesake of Yahshua HaMashiach. Nothing more greater. Nothing. His strength is pronounced. And he will journey to places and people will ask, where are you from? You're a stranger. Although he's been among them for many years. We just haven't been taught. The reason we haven't been taught because we don't know how to listen. Prime example that the imam shows the child how to do something. Within seconds, they say, I got it. I know how to do it, Mama. I got it, Daddy. That's the way we are. Of course, we hear it or we read it. I got it. Stop it. So we can look at those that, as Yahshua says, as he set a trial among them. And said, unless you become as one of these little ones, you will in no wise enter into the kingdom. Yah is the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. That's why we are not consumed. So I have no style. I responded to one this morning. I said, I'm a simple man that with all of my effort, I try to bring clarity to Torah with a preponderance of evidence what Torah expressed, not how I was taught by those that I revered greatly, but by simply sitting down with a book and open it and to understand one simple dimension of it. Because I know that every word he speaks is pure. To understand that word. To understand that word. You do not understand the syntax of his grammatics, his speech, or the writing. You cannot defy what he says. You will never get understanding. You can read it all day. You can color it, your Torah, like a coloring book. It means nothing. Hallelujah. We must understand each word that he utters. It's almost like a parent saying to the child, what word you don't understand? What you don't understand about no. And so every word is pure. And we need the fullness. Yahshua came in the fullness of Torah. And we need the fullness. We need the fullness of his imats. We need that. Without that, we're not going to progress. We're not going to grow. And it will be the same things that cause us to fall every time. We don't deal with our shame, our own iniquity. Our own sin, our own vile nature, our own corrupt ways. We don't want to deal with that. We don't want to see what impugnant things we do and how we practice such devious, wicked works that have their seeding in our minds. We don't want to see that. You can tell me how this one has failed. That one. And tell me how righteous you are. When you see a righteous man, you follow that man. You will know because the end of that man is shalom. You mock that man. You use the word us. You say in your heart, I know he's a righteous man. I'm going to do as he does. I want to walk the way he walks. Mark that man that is sadiq. For the inn, for the kids. When that man sits down at the end of the day through all of his turmoils and battles, he has great shalom. He has great shalom. And you see the shalom in his ponim. He wakes up with shalom. His words are filled with the covenant of shalom. He has a brits. He has a covenant. He has an allegiance, an alliance. His heart is satisfied with the fatness of this truth churning and turning in his mind. He reminds himself by stirring up the mind of Yahshua, but the witness of Torah as he labors to understand. So produce this ambience, this great richness about him. And he looks rich. She looks strong. Her tifrah is beyond, beauty beyond the superlatives. The verbs or the adverbs and to express the greatness for beauty. And that's a fact. And then they will ask, where are you from? Are you from here? No. I'm from another world. The little one in the house the other day, and she says to me, she saw the videos of what we teach here, and she says to me, play that. She wants to hear her vats, the chain, play that one, both of them. And I said to her, little girl, you get it live. And I find you rusting, or, oh, please play it. I said to her, I'll tell you what on Shabbat, Wednesday, you'll get a live review. Don't go to sleep. How about that? Yah sends his liveliness among us. I want to conclude in this teaching on the Mishpatchem, the judgment, before Almighty Yah. Why it must be a prominent component among us. Don't we want to love everything that Yah loves? Yes. So if He loves His people, should not we love them? Yes. If He shows His chassid, His steadfast love kindness to His nation, should not we show the very same thing? Should we not search the Torah to find out what things He loves? Yes. Yet we don't do it. We must become real with ourselves and judge ourselves accordingly. I want to begin here. I think it's vitally important. Makes no difference whether you bear with me. But I want to read this as we were singing, dancing. David speaks from the depths of his heart. Because this man knows what things Yah loves. I want to know what He loves. What His affection is. There are those that will tell you, for Yah so loved the world, gave Yahshua. Of course they don't say that. But I want to understand what He loves. Can I read from the book? Well, I shall. Whether you give me confirmation or not, I shall read. How about that? I want to be gone here in the writings, the Tehillim, the musical oration of David, as his heart would sing of the great gladness of the Abba, as he would rejoice in the great victorious manifestation of the power of Yah's hand among His nation. So He gives us a great jubilation here when He commands us. He tells us to rejoice in Yah. And there's only one that can do that. He say, oh, you Sadiq, oh, you righteous. Nobody else can rejoice in Yah but the righteous. He said, for praises, for the exaltation that is comely, it is a common thing among us. When it is not coming out of your loins, you know you're not righteous. You have not judged yourself accordingly. It is comely. It is a fervor of activity that when you see children, what is comely with them when they're outside? They play. And they run. You can hear their voices. You can hear their voices. You can hear the sounds of their voices. So it is a comely or a common thing among them. He commands us to praise Him on the harp. Strings of the harp, they're there. It is just simply the refined technology that brings the very sound more precisely. He says, and also sing unto him with the psaltery, with your timbrels and your dulcimer. I was looking at the string instrument Zochin Yaramaya playing over there, and I said, it's just not quite 10. We'll get to 10 one day, all right? And he says, and an instrument of 10 strings. Why? Why he commands us that? He tells us to sing. Shir songs. Sing unto him a renewed song. Same words. But allow it to be renewed in your bosom, your shirts. So the way you sing it today, as you hear the teaching of Torah, your heart is refined and judged. Then you take that same song and you sing it with a great enthusiasm. There has to be a change about his people daily. The weather changes all the time. The patterns, the wind streams, the jet streams. He says, sing unto him a new song. He tells us to play skillfully. I believe that our Akim played skillfully. He gets on that thing. Sweat pouring everywhere. So he commands us to play skillfully, with knowledge, with purpose, and to understand why we are playing. He said, make sure that it's loud. Why? Why? For the Torah, the Dabarim, the word of Yah, the promises of Yah, they are right. No wrong in it. You're right. You're right. And all of his works, his labor, his mitzvah, they are done in Emah, truth. They're done by the revelation of Yeshua HaMashiach. I don't care what kind of physical activity you produce, it must be done in Emah, truth. And he tells us why. He sums it up here. Tehillim chapter 33. He sums it up here. He says, Yah. He loves. He adores. This is the strength of his bosom. He loves Sadiq. He loves righteousness. He loves his character personified in us. He loves righteousness. And he loves judgment. And we are not a people that's captivated with either one. We love lies. We love our own vile mannerisms. And our judgment is so damnable corrupt. But Yah loves righteousness. And he loves judgment. Now, if Yah loves righteousness, we better, with all of our substance, get a clear understanding of the Sadiq of Yah and the Mishpatim. His power to judge, to assess, to make the correct judgment, the assessment of the matter according to his mind. His mind is everlasting. It is an eternal mind. So he is the one that loves righteousness. We hate righteousness. We have disdain for anything that is right. We love lies, hypocrisy, and sin, our wicked ways, our corrupt thoughts. And we don't want that to be judged. There's a reason why. As a young, ignorant young man preaching, of course, those that were part of the fellowship, they thought that his ability to extract was just so wonderful and excellent. So when I look back on those days, I saw the juvenileness of my actions, my mentality, still juvenile. But yet, the Kiddushim would say, oh, what a great blessing. And if my path, I desire to go the way of a conglomerate of corporations, believe me, I could have had the people. I could have drawn them from every profession because I knew who would call me and the calls I got in those years. I know. That was never my passion. And there was one thing that I will always say to us, I'm quite sure I know, because last Shabbat, I believe she said, I remember your teaching on that desire of the heart all those years ago. And I've taught it many times in different capacities. But I would say to us, there is only one spirit among a nation, especially Israel. And we'll bring it down to the utterest depths of darkness, and that is the spirit of zana, prostitution, whoredom. No other. You can kill a man. And there was a place of refuge for those, whether they were Gentiles, and whether they were homeborn by the Ruach and the birth of Yah. We must love judgment. We must love righteousness. He says the earth, the Olam, it is full, it is tome. It runs over with the Tav of Yah. He woke us all up this morning. He given us breath to go forth and to sing and to dance. He has given us that, Yisrael. I will not withhold what he loves from him. He brings judgment before us to make his presence known unto us. By the power of his Torah were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. There is nothing that has been done that has not been done by his living vapor, his ruach. When he made man, he breathed him into man. And he became the composition of Yah until he fell. And the revelation, the power of Yahshua is ever present with his nation until we sin after a heart that is willing. And the reason that heart is unwilling, because we have forgotten Yah. There's a reason that we forgot. I want to establish this. I'm going to teach. David says here in another place, in Tehillim 76, he says unto Yah, though even you, Yah, thou art to be Yerah, you are to be feared and reverenced. We ought to come into Yah's house prepared. Yes. There's nothing more sickening and more vile when we are not prepared when we come. I say to you all, you should not go to sleep in Yah's house. I can understand an old woman like that getting older. Someone like that. Your men should be refreshed every Shabbat. Your countenance should be refreshed. Your daughters of Tizayon. You don't go to a damn job and do that. It's amazing that they can sit at the computer for hours and never get sleeping. I was thinking this morning, I said, Yah, you know when a mother's child gets sick and they're afraid, the first thing they do, take them, especially when they have no insurance, they take them to the hospital, the emergency room. And I was thinking about that Mothers won't bring their babies to the Zachin to pray. Because hell, most of them, the majority of them, are so simple and silly, you have no confidence in them praying and Yah hearing them. Some of them are mean as hell and not the light and the life of Yah's Ruach. But a mother will take that child, although the child is sick. When Yah commands us, the Zachin Yaramaya taught us to bring them before the elders. And search your heart, mama, and your heart, daddy. I've seen it too many times, and the baby can be sick unless there is a traumatic case. You go to the emergency room, they're not going to see you right off. You're going to sit there. Mothers will sit there for hours with the baby in their arm, baby sick, and watch, and they are tuned to everything that's around them. And their wait is not 10 minutes or 20 minutes. The wait is hours. And yet mothers and fathers will not bring their babies to the messenger, the man of Yah, to the Zachin, and say, pray. But they'll sit there all day in an emergency room. This is how sick we have become. We're sick. You are to be feared, Yah, and who may stand in your sight once when you are angry or the Ibra of Yah, who can stand in the presence of Yah? Who can stand in their own counsel against Yah's counsel? He says, you, O Yah, you have caused judgment to be heard. For what reason? Why has he caused the judgment to be heard from Shemayim? What? You have caused your judgment to be heard from heaven. He says, the earth feared and the earth was still. We get quiet. When this judgment goes forth, we get quiet, don't we? For what reason? Can I tell you why he sends this judgment? The importance of it. When Yah arose, and he stood up in the Kadosh place. When Yah rose, when he arose to judge, why does he arise to judge? Why? There's only one reason. Who shall inherit the earth? The meek. So he rose up to save all the meek in the earth. And he says, Silah, praise the sing unto Yah. So when Yah rises up, causes judgment to rise up in us, he does that to save the meek from the earth. It is vitally important. What has diminished the power of his mishpatim, his judgment, among his people? Nation that was full of the judgment. There is something that has arisen. When Yah rises up, he judged the earth to save us. Yashak, to deliver me from me. To deliver you from your own ashame, your own chata, the sins that are perpetrated and done. And also from our avon, our iniquitous defiance of Torah, when Torah is not our delight. So he rises up. He stands up to judge the earth, to save the meek. Those that are humble, those that are the dal or the oni, no fight. Of course, we have great resistance to Yah, don't we? We fight against the messenger. I have found over the many years the hypocrisy of men because they say they love you. I appreciate the few that have been faithful to me over the years. I understand my plight, I do. I'm not upset. So when a man finds a friendship in this life, he's found a great treasure. Just one if he gets that. The multitude has loved me. And they all have said, I will stand with you. But I will cut. The Torah will cut. It makes no difference. But when I find a defiance or I find a spirit that is not mature in Yah's house, I don't give a damn who it is. It's you. You. Makes no difference. I will destroy it. That's a fact. That's a proper protocol in Yah's house. There's one thing I learned for employment. When I would go for an interview, I knew how to sit. How did you learn that? By watching other men. I knew how to appear. I knew how to focus. I've gotten every job I've interviewed for. There's not a job I've gotten it. I'd take the job over those that are much more qualified than me. When I worked at IBM, the promotions were there for me, but the system was wicked. And Yah never intended for me to go into the depths of the cauldron of that darkness. That's a fact. No one. No one. I want to show us something. Again, as I read last week, we'll read this again, that I want to get into the depths of this teaching and show us what has happened, what has been the, what has been this tremendous power of regression, this canker of cancer that has eaten the values of Yah from even those that think that they're strong men. Yah says to his nation, Tehillim, Psalms 9. David says, Yah is Yada. He is no. Your experience with Yah comes by an attribute that is so profound. He is known by the judgment, the Mishpat. It says, which he execute or asah, which he fashions. Yah established judgment. How is it established by Torah? That's why men have to be wise to understand the beauty of Torah. He is the one that fashioned judgment. He says there is one called the Rasha, the wicked. Those that have no love for Torah. Those that defy Torah. Those that have no delight in Torah. The wicked. He uses the word as we have taught, Nachash. He is snared by his own demons. His own defiance. He is snared in the works of his own hand. And he cries with the salutation, Higagon. That he says to Yah, my meditation is resounding. It is truth. And not only that, he cries, Selah. I lift you up, Yah. I esteem you. Because you have made known who you are by your judgment. We have wise men that dig into the depths of Torah. There is not one situation that they will not define for us. And in defining that situation, that sin, it redefines us and refines us so that we will not be willing to sin against the Most High. And that our hearts are stable and our minds are stable. Yes. We're steadfast. Yeah. What has been the cancerous effect? What has affected us? We must get to the root of that. We must get to the root of it. And the Novi speaks so profoundly here in the book of Yeshua, Isaiah. Isaiah, read the whole chapter 1, that you may understand the dynamics and the details of what the prophet uttered. He says in Isaiah, Yeshua, he talks about this city of Emun, a faithful city, one that is enraptured because Yerushalayim is the teaching of Shalom. It is the teaching of Yah's covenant. It is the revelation of Yah's covenant with his people. It is the Dabarim, the promises of Yah. So the cry goes out to the nation. He says in Yeshaya chapter 1, the prophet says, the cry of Yah's heart, his love. Yah loves judgment. He loves righteousness. What is this great demise of my people? What is causing them to be eaten like a cancerous disease? What is the cause? He says, how is the faithful city, Yerushalayim, the teaching of Shalom? That's why we cannot worship Yah, but in, as the Syrophoenician woman said to Yeshua, that there is only one place we can worship him, and that is in Yerushalayim. He said, you're right, woman. Yah looks for those he has commanded his nation to worship him in the Ruach and in Torah. She was not wrong. It was the city, it's the place, it is the mine of Shalom, where the covenant of Shalom, where the alliance and the allegiance of Yah flow from us to keep us in the perfect place where Yah commands us to be. So how is the faithful city Yerushalayim, man? How has that city become a harlot, a zana, a religious prostitute? We prostitute ourselves to all kinds of occultic ideas that come from our mind. We sell ourselves to our own idolatry, our own wickedness, our own self-worth. We judge me to be lesser. I judge you to be lesser than me. It's not so. How has a faithful city? He identifies her as a faithful city. How has she become a harlot? There's nothing more despicable than a whore in the sight of Yah. She has to be counted as a damn dog among the nations. There's nothing more vile. One says, well, I can't do it. No, you need judgment, Jezebel. You need judgments, man, you whoremonger of darkness. That's how you get it done, by judgment. They prostitute themselves. How is one that is faithful? How is the faithful city? How has that city become a harlot? Look at what Yah says in Isaiah 1:21. This is important. Yah says that it was money. It was full. The abundance, the riches, the debts, the value, the great values of the riches. Yah says it was full of judgment and righteousness large in it. The things that Yah loved. It was full of mishpats. It was full of it. How has she become a whore? How has a city, how has a mind become so entrenched with the harlotry aspects of life that one has written off Yah? That even we can sin and the fear of judgment doesn't even touch us. The fear of judgment doesn't even grasp our hearts to warn us. How has a city that was full of judgment, How has one with the covenant of Shalom, full of judgment, and full of the tzaddik of Yah, become a whore? How has one become a whore? You see, even though I said those things in ignorance, I knew it was truth, my heart, my iman. I will show you according to the book. How has a city become so full of harlotry? Zadah, that they sell themselves, a mother, sell herself like a dog. The drunkenness of her lust, even the inebriating of her own wickedness, the drunkenness, and I'm talking about the yayin, the strong drink. There are women that get drunk and they think it's all right. You might as well say hallelujah, you damn hypocrite. The men that get drunk. How has a faithful city become a whore? When it was full of judgment and full of the tzaddik of Yah. So David's statement that Yah loves the judgment and he loves righteousness. It is on time. This is what keeps the city renowned. This is what keeps us in the right perspective of Torah. She's become a whore. Can I teach this, my friend? I am with line upon line. I'm going to teach this. Greetings, our friends. She has become a whore. She was full of the judgment and the tzaddik of Yah at large in her. It says now she has become a rosach, a murderer. I'm not a murderer. If you hate Yisrael, you hate your ach, your chutz, without no cause, there's no cause, then you have become a rosach. You're an enemy. You hate, you despise. It is expressed in your anger, your hostility, your vile nature, your immaturity. How has a city that is full of judgment has become a place of minds that murders and kills and destroy our achim, our chutchim? How has it become? Because the judgment was not done in tzaddik. Well, I need him, so I don't want to touch him, nor damn him. He's a wicked beast. He has no damn character. She has no utterance of truth from her wicked loins. A beautiful daughter of Tizayon. She walks among the elders. The elders say, what is this? That's what it says in Mishli 31. Hell, they walk around like Bishop would say, mincing and the... And they're twisting at their bangles and they want to be seen. Her beauty is beyond any kind of express superlatives. That's why when the Zachim, when they look upon her, they see the value of her man. There's nothing more beautiful than a beautiful woman. By the means of a whore, we're not going to bring Yahshua down. By the means of a whorish woman, a man is brought down to a piece of bread. She kills a man. I don't give a damn how wicked the man has been. I don't give a damn how immature he is. It is your beauty, woman. It is the beauty of your knowledge when you obey that will bring the resolution to that man's heart. But by the means of a damn Jezebel, a whore, man is brought down to a piece of bread. He has no value, he has no life. I was thinking, my friend, even my issue on all of her ignorance, she would always say to me, you're a strong, beautiful man. There's nothing, man, you cannot do. I had no motivation. I had no strength. I had no resolve. Yet those words would cause me to rise up. And the reflection of those words, they were begun to build momentum and strengthen my bosom. She would say, you can't do anything. Okay, what it is? She was impressed. I had nothing to impress her with. Didn't have no money. Didn't have no education.
didn't have no high profile position, didn't have a damn thing. All I had to offer was my genuine love. That's it. And I knew I would love her. I knew I would love her. I knew I would love her. I knew that. I knew that. It was real. Didn't understand it, but I knew I would love her. And so those words were the catalysts of momentum to build me, to make me strong. I don't give a damn how wrong I did. I don't care how my attitude was. It was always those refreshing words that strengthened my bosom. And believe me, I knew then I could do it. And that's a fact. That's why we see the very process that when Yeshua came up out of the sepulchre, the women were there, the assembly, the true house. Hallelujah. That's the beauty of that woman and the beauty of the assembly. It was reflected in Miriam Magdalene, although she was a hoe, yet it was that judgment as she wept at the feet of HaMashiach, washed his feet with her tears, to know what a great kindness that something like me, it is your judgment that changed me. That's why they asked, do you know who this Jezebel is? He said, Simeon, I've come to your house and you haven't given me one glass of water. But yet this woman, her sins are many unknown. Too much is given, much is required. And she gave the perfect offering and the complete reverence unto him. How does a city like that becomes a whore and become so vile and become a city full of murderers? I'm saying this to let you know. There's nothing more vile than that spirit. It brings death. It brings separation. I will prove it through the course of Torah and this teaching. I want to remind us in our whoredom, our zana, as we prostitute ourselves, we sell ourselves to our own thoughts and our ideas. There are those that will say in the day, they will say, I got to do what I got to do, player. Well, what you're about to do is wicked. You need to do what's right, what Yah says do. And all you're doing hasn't produced one damn substance of life, nothing but death. And we're filthy and we're unclean. We stink like dogs. And I warn all of us, when Yah gives us much, you continue in that way. Yah says that he that is often rebuked and reproved. You see, we harden our hearts. Then he commands then suddenly destruction. The shahath comes. Yah says, I'm not going to warn you. So you that are listening, you that will hear this, you that are sitting here, he warns you today. He warns you. You think you're getting by, but you're not getting by. Your filth is going to be revealed. I'm going to teach. To show you how vile this nature is and why it calls us to forget, I must cause my eyes to peer what appear into the revelation of Yohanan. In Revelation Giliana, Revelation chapter 17. He says that there came unto me one of the seven Melachim. And the seven Melachim represents the perfect order of Yah's administration. It has been complete. There is nothing. There is no revisiting yet. You can revive it. It is complete. It is the thorough perfect perfection of Yah. His Tomi. And so one of the seven Melachim, which had the seven vials of the seven bowls, he began to speak and to talk with me. He says to me, enter in here. There's only one way we can enter into truth, through Yahshua at the gate. So he said, enter in through this revelation revealed unto you. He says to him, come here. He shall, I will show you the judgment. I will show you the judgment. That's why it's vitally important for us to understand judgment. It is a valuable component that we must have access to and access. He said, I will show you the judgment, and y'all calls her a great whore. She is a zana. She is an occult prostitute. She prostituted herself for the mere cheapness of what she is. She stinks like a French whore. He said, I'm going to show you the judgment. It calls her a great prostitute. Why do you use the word gadol? Because she boasts in her own conversation. She speaks with a loud, raggedy, wicked voice. She wants you to know who she is. And she stinks like a damn dog. He calls her a great whore that sits upon many waters. Well, this is the mindset, the conscience of many, that this spirit of whoredom. And so in this dialogue with the Melech and Yahkahan, he was somewhat baffled. He gives him a conclusion to this vision. In the same chapter, the Melech says to me, the waters which you saw, the Mayim, the great depths of the water, where the horse sits, it sits in the mind. She sits there, this Nahash. We do all things through the power, revelation of Yahshua HaMashiach. Never done anything of myself. I can't do it. I've wondered even all this week, as old folks would say, how do we even make ends meet? But Yah is our way maker, as the old folks would say. They had true tikvah. They didn't have hope. They had tikvah. They waited for the promise with expectation. Hope is simply say, I just wait. If it comes, it comes. If it doesn't, no. Tikvah says it's coming. And so the spirit of this horse sits upon the waters. And so the waters, he said, you saw, Yahkahan, where the horse sits, those are the people. That's the people. That's the mindset of this generation. He said, and the multitudes and nations and all kinds of tongues that they speak. So the waters you saw represent the masses of the people, whereby this vile nature that has been propagated, hybridized through this Bavel spirit, one of confusion and defiance of Yah. We defy Yah, don't we? Oh, I know we hypocrites will say, oh, I don't defy him. I loved his Torah. I love you, preacher. You damn liar. Don't love me. It is the people, it is the masses, it is the nations. That's the Mayim, the waters. Our bodies are vast percentage of water, about 78% water. That's all it is. And when it dies, the maggots are going to eat it. We better prepare to die, and the only way you prepare to die is by judgment. You better judge yourself, unless you become a murderer. You become a murderer, judgment must fill your heart and righteousness. I want to do right, Yah. Show me. Correct me in your judgment. Not in your hostility of your Ibra that you caused me to be annihilated. I don't want that. I have no purpose in life, none, but to make sure that I dispense what Yah reveals unto me. I'm not looking for riches. I'm not looking for name recognition. One wrote me this morning, said, I meet many people. I asked them, have you heard of Riach, the Teshua, and those there? She said, ignorant world, it's lost. One writes me the other day and say that the Hebrews don't really care for you. That's all right. Yahshua said, we'll be hated by all men for his name's sake. For the sake of his name, we defend his true name. Not some damn Jesus.
I don't defend no style. I don't have to have style. I got his mind. So when I go, people wonder, are you boasting that? Yes, I make my boast in him. I was out the other day. The woman says to me, she says, are you from here? And I said, well, certainly. I live in a small town called Jefferson, South Carolina. And she was taken a wash. I'm dressed no different than any other man. It's not the dress. I'm not going to stop saying that. Because we are a Segula people. I'm not going to stop saying it. I'm not going to stop telling the incidents. Hallelujah. He says, and the 10 horns of the Kereb, the 10 horns, the 10 tribes of Ephraim, this is the power that has ruled in the minds of the northern nation of Samaria, because she was a whore. I'll prove it. The 10 horns which you saw upon the beast, these shall hate the whore. They realize they have been sold into the captivity of their mind. I was thinking the other day, and I began to compile a message one night. I was up to about 11. I'm compiling this message as to the controlling of one's mind. It's not going to be done by some damn chip they're going to put in you. It's not going to be done that way. I will show us from the book, Yisra'yah. They shall hate the whore, and they shall make her desolate and naked. I want you to remember those words, the nakedness, all right? The nakedness, it has great substance. They will make her naked and shall eat her flesh. And they're going to burn every horn. They're going to burn her. For the fire of Yah, the power of his word, that's what consumes a whore. The spirit of our minds, it must be destroyed. You destroy with judgment. You keep doing what you got to do, all right? In hell, you're going to lift your eyes. You keep doing your own. Your way may seem right, but you know it's wicked. It's a way that seems right unto every man or woman, but the end thereof is death. It's my faith. You're going to die prematurely. A mother produced daughters, Beth Ula. A whore produce a whore. And the thoughts of our mind are steeped in idolatry and whoredom. That's why we hate. It's so easy for us to hate. You show your hatred toward one another with your damn hostility and your anger. You get so mad. You get so angry. Why? Because you're a damn fool, and anger rests in the bosom of a damn fool. You get angry, you get hostile. People don't kill people because they're happy when they kill them. It is the hostility and our anger. We hate our hearts. We are murderers. And the reason why, because our minds are not full of judgment. Our minds are just mental against others, but our minds are not full of judgment. We have no judgment in our minds. We don't like judgment. Keep walking in the spirit of a whore. A whore always dresses herself up to think that to make someone wants to buy her. And she stinks. She's a stinking dog. I'll prove it. Hallelujah. Yah says in Gilead 19:2, as he reveals unto us the nature of a whore, he says again, Yakahan, the messenger of Yah, says, for true emats, Torah righteousness, for true and righteous are his judgment. They're righteous and they're full of truth. It's mishpatim. For he has judged the great whore. She's already judged. That's why Yahshua did not come into the world to condemn it. Why? Because, damn it, it was condemned already. You already condemned whore.
You're not a Rahab. He sits to judge the great whore, what? Which did corrupt the earth with her fornication. She calls everyone that she talks to practice such insidious, devious activities. And that's what we do when we don't keep judgment in our hearts. We make opinions about things. An opinion is one's ability to assess and to make judgment according to their knowledge, which is so damn corrupt. That's all your opinion is. So she calls that spirit of prostitution, of idolatry, to spread forth from the earthen vessel. And that's why women get together and they run their damn mouths about folly. And foolishness. And that's why silly women love silly women. A mature woman wants to be around a mature woman. A woman that has the self-identity of herself. She's attractive and beautiful. She likes women that are beautiful like her because it reveals her beauty. And a damn ugly, unclean woman, this whorehouse we call, quote, the church, unquote, she's a dirty, filthy, flea-ridden whore. How about that? And fleas love fleas. I don't give a damn how you assess me. Your assessing is not of great value. Y'all's going to judge this great whore which corrupt. She has shahath. She has corrupt the earth with her own fornication. And he's going to avenge the dam, the blood of his servants at her hand. We have impaled the servants of Yah. We have spoke against them with great indignation. We have lied against them. We have impaled their character. We have spoken evil against them. Yah said, but the blood is on your damn wicked hand. Yah is going to condemn every wicked tongue that rise up in judgment against the messengers of Yah. I'm not some drop shot that teaching you some kind of culture. I teach you the nature of a nation that has no concept of Yah. Why? Because of the spirit of whoredom. And we don't understand. Yah is showing us the gravity of this. That we stop our damn wicked childlike ways. He showed us that. That's what he's showing us. We must have Geba, strong men, warriors. If nothing, man, your words will be a strength unto that young, powerful messenger of Yah. Your attitude, the way you walk, the way you talk, the way you carry yourself, personify the dignity and the strength of Yahshua's character. Well, that's what they said about Yahshua. Who is this man? I met a man like him. So when they say that to me, I like that. So I don't personify what the world. I walk with a boldness, with a dignity, a strength. I don't give a damn if I got on dirty blue jeans just coming from the garden. I don't have to get dressed to do nothing. I dress every day. I dress myself in the Law, the clothes of Sadiq. We need to dress our minds, dress our hearts. Those are my garments. Those are my garments. I don't need no $300, $500 suit. Never owned a $150 suit in all of my life. Never owned one. Don't even have a $150 suit. Don't even have a suit in the house that's $100. The max is $50. Hear the word of Yah, Yisrael. Hear this. A whore always corrupts the land. And when you allow that mindset to overtake you, listen, this is what happened. I want you to hear that. This is what, who would know, who could give us a greater wisdom and understanding of this better than, who could give us a greater insight than the mashal or the proverbs of Shaul.
No one else can he. This is what he says in Mishlei. He says, I want you all to hear this. He says, for whore is a deep ditch. She is an amok. You know, you've heard the people say, you're nothing but an amok of, you're just in an amok of mess. And she is a deep ditch. She is a deep ditch. She is a deep ditch. And when anyone goes into that hoarder mindset, you don't come out of it. When you're captivated by that spirit, you don't come out of that spirit. You don't come up out of it, Yisraya. Whore's a deep ditch. And a strange woman, she's a narrow pit. When you find one that is estranged from the commonwealth of Yisraya, how do I know? Because their conversation is about folly. You judge your conversation. We don't judge our conversation. We don't judge our activities. We talk silly. We talk loud. We talk stupid. We talk crazy. We love talking with the wicked and talking about nothing. How are you going to show somebody the way of Yah when you live like a damn dog? How are we going to express that? I was talking with one the other day, and the person said to me, I just love to look at the little ones on that front row when they always just singing, and they just, we sit here like them dumps deadheads, don't we? They're you that don't even know how you got your sanctimonious ways. That's all you do. You're wicked. I did it in the world. And I was bad too. Sure I did. I was. Yaka dance. Yeah, she could. Yes, sir. The sanctimonious wickedness. And those that will visit us, I try to accommodate them by send you fellowship with him too. Because I know that this ach has a different demeanor, that they can soothe the crushing blows. Of course, you don't see too many that come back. That's just a fact. It's a fact. I hit the body strong and I hit it hard. We are the body of Yeshua. And so when I pounce on it, I hit very hard. I hit hard physically, too. I still can, mama. I'm telling you. That surprised me at times. Because if we do not correct ourselves by judgment, him judging us, woe unto us, nation. We're in for a great cataclysmic demise of death and destruction. We must understand the spirit of whoredom. This prostituting the Torah of Yah for our own conveniences. We deny just the convenient us. You're going to have to stop that today. Zachin Bidamin is always telling us that we must have true repentance. We must make teshuva. We must turn. When we hear the truth, we must turn. Proceeding on, Yisraya. Hallelujah. He's going to judge this great whore as a reward to her. And I will show you how this instinct developed in us. Revelation 21:8. Yah categorized the elements that are totally against him and that which will enter into the kingdom knowledge. A whore's mind will never enter into the knowledge of the kingdom truth. He says in the kingdom of the Melchut, he said, those that are fearful, those that are fearful of the opposition, those that are fear of others turning against them, those that are fearful, those that are fearful of themselves and fearful of losing something, and the unbelieving, those that don't believe, Yah. To the pure, all things are pure, but to those that are defiled and unbelieving, there's nothing pure. They don't believe no one is right, you understand? Yah says there's a vendetta I have against those that are fearful. And those that are unbelieving, he talks about the abominable, those that defy, that sell Torah,
for the rite of passage into the ways of the gates of darkness. He talks about the murderer, a guy. We see how this spirit is developed. When there is no judgment and no loving of judgment and righteousness, you find a murderous mind. You find those that will cahoot together in their prostituting, occult idolatry, mindset, and they will defame the character of those that they call Ach and Achot. And it is just the truth. He says, and no whoremonger, no zana, no occult prostitute. You sell yourself. No cult prostitute. He talks about the sorceress. I'm going to teach you on that soon. The safa, the distorting, the corruption of one's mind, whereby one defies Yah in every detail. And he says, and all liars, all liars. There's nothing more vile than one that's a liar. All liars. He didn't even say all murderers, but he said murderers. But he wanted us to understand all liars. Every liar shall have their part in the lake which burn with the fire and brimstone, which is the second death. You don't come up out of that. You can play all you want to. You play all you want to, all liars. There's a reason that daughter's a liar. There's a reason that daughter's a whore. He gave the woman one of the most precious responsibility that one can have, to be a strength to make the man, to help him meet Yah's obligation, and to feed the titty milk into the mouths of babes. You take a cow in the field. When she becomes full of milk, when she calves, then all the other little calves can go and draw from her teat. They can draw from her breast. And every mother, every ima, we must be able to draw from the breast of the mother. Young men will go to their mothers for counsel, and they could draw from their breasts. Although the daddy was stern and firm, they could draw from that comfort. We don't have a damn thing today. We don't have it. Rebellious young women, defiant, they have no beauty. I don't give a damn how you can get it tight on your ass. It doesn't mean a damn thing. It's the most silly man that look at you. And if you draw his attention, you're not drawing much. If a woman goes out to draw my attention, she's not drawing much. That's a fact. The Torah says, young man, turn from a shapely woman when you see her. Old men would just watch. I've seen it. Turn from a shapely woman when she entered your presence. Run. Never forget, Mama, I told the story. I remember when I was going to rejoin the military again. I was going to do a career. I wanted to be a military police officer. I remember going to the recruiting station. And this woman by the world standards, she had it. So she looks at me, she said, oh, I'll take you home and cook you a steak. And I'm somewhat becoming very unnerved. She said, I was just playing. She said, no, I wasn't. Go home with me. I will never forget, I got out of that place and I ran. I caught the bus to go down there. We didn't have one vehicle. And I ran. I didn't even understand what I was doing. Yah was saying, you flee that young, strong, bull lust young man. You flee it. Flee you for lust. And I will never forget, I ran and I ran, and I never went back. There are those that will go back and see, I never went back. I didn't even trust myself to go back. I trusted what he said. Didn't even know that was in the book, but I knew it was in the book, because he has put the book here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Yah says, that this nature of those that, especially the whoremonger, it caused you to forget the ways of Yah. The spirit of whoredom calls you to forget, and you forget so very easily, Yisrael. There's a reason why there's going to be such a severe judgment upon that mindset and that nature. Moshe gives us a directive from Yah in Devarim chapter 31. And Yah spoke unto Moshe, says, behold, you shall go to sleep with your avat, and this people shall rise up. When Yah rises up to judge, you understand? He said, this people shall rise up, and they're going to go a whoring after the gods and the strangers. And that's what we do. We go to whoring after our own concept and our own mind evaluation of things. We evaluate everyone but ourselves. The wife evaluate the husband. The husband evaluate the wife. But no one evaluate themselves. And no one receive the wise counsel because no one wants to be judged. One that is wise always receive judgment. You prove, reprove one, or speak to one, the Musa, the counsel of Yah, they will love you. You speak to a fool, you're going to get your blood. They get angry, they get mad. They get angry as hell. They get mad. He said, you go on to sleep, they're going to rise up and go whoring after the gods of the land. There, he says, where they go to be among them. And this, when you began to go whoring, I want you all that at home, you that are listening, if you get no other verse, you get all of them, you get this one. Devarim 31:16. Listen to it again. Just listen. Now, you never listen to it again. You're not even inspired to listen. You're not even inspired to hear what the Ruach speaks. He said, because they're going to rise up. And that's what a fool's mind does. Nobody tell me. He doesn't understand my situation. You're just wicked, man. Woman, you are a cheap piece of trash. You are flat out hoe. You're less than a dog. You're less than a damn dog, woman. You're a whoremonger, man. You are a piece of dung. Let's get real. You say you know Yah, you're a damn liar. You love Yah, you're a flat out liar. Man says he loves Yah, keeps not his mitzvah. You're a liar. You commit not the fornication, but yet you do. You sell yourself like a cheap piece of a stinking prostitute to every kind of wicked concept. There's nothing more beautiful than a mother. There's nothing. Above all things, I want to be a man that the young daughters, I want them to see a man even in my old age. And ones that are grown, I want them to see the beauty of a man. I want the young men to see a man, his strength and his character, the beauty of a man. That's what I want. I'm not looking for no riches. I'm not looking for things in life. I don't know what I would want if I asked for anything. Make sure we had enough funds for us to be taken care of. That's all. I'm not worried about anything else. Nothing else. I don't need nothing. He said, they will go out among the heathens. We do that, don't we? We go among the heathens, we laugh, and we grin like a damn jackass. And lie. And your witness has no power. It has no authority. You will never be able to witness. Never. Because they know you are nothing but a damn hypocrite. He says, because they have gone a-whoring, he uses this word. He says, they will azab. They will forget. We forget Yah in the morning. We forget him in the close of the day. He's not even on our minds when that spirit of whoredom overrides us. This is what brings death to a nation. When we began to prostitute themselves, and a prostitute will prostitute their daughters as well. The mama whore, the daughter is going to be a whore. That's a fact. That's a fact. They will sell them to whoredom. They will encourage them to do things that are so vile because there is no incrimination upon them. Hell, there have been drug addict whores say, baby, don't do what I do. I'm a wicked mammy. I'm not worth a damn. Sure it is. That's all right. I got you covered here. When one Azab, they leave Yah behind, he said, they will leave me behind. He said, they will forsake me. And then he says, they will break my bread, which I have made with them. They will break the covenant of Yah. They will defy the covenant of Yah. They will destroy his allegiance. They will not keep the commands of Yah. They will break my covenant. He says, when they do that, then my anger shall be kindled against them in that day. He said, I'm going to kill them. I'm going to kill their babies. It takes, when you come to the knowledge of the truth, you mothers with your little children, you got to be a cheap piece of geluch. And I say it this way, you got to be a cheap piece of shit. And you don't care enough about them to love them. That your life personifies the beauty of this book. You're not even a cheap slut. You teach them and you train them in the ways of Yah. You're not even a cheap slut. You're not worth a damn. I don't care who you are. I'm talking to you. You're not worth a piece of dung. I don't give a damn who you are. You can pretend all you want to, Jezebel. Yah says, because of that, my anger is going to rise up. He said, my anger shall rise up and I will kindle it against them in that day. He says, and I will azab. They have forsaken me. I'm going to forsake them. Read Proverbs 1, Mishlei 1. When you're going to cry, when your anguish and the anger of death come upon you, Yah says, I'm going to mock you, you whore, you filthy Jezebel. You will not receive reproof. You can think it's somewhat comical. And you can, in your stupid pride, think that it is of no value. Keep on. He said, because you have forsaken me, I will forsake you, and I will hide my face from them. And they shall be destroyed. They shall be devoured. And he says, and many rob. He says, many evils and troubles shall befall them. That's why we're so troubled in our spirit. He said, the evils and the troubles shall befall them. So that they will say in that day, are not these evil come upon us because Yah our Abba is not among us? We don't have the intestinal fortitude of wisdom and strength to say, why is this upon me? Yah has removed his called name, his face for me because of my wickedness, because of my whoredom. His judgment is no more in my heart. I don't delight in the judgment of Yah. How many of us truly delight in the judgment of Yah? We don't delight in Yah's judgment. We don't delight in correction. I say, Lord, when my mother would whip my backside, I would always try to do things to mend that whipping. Clean the house, pick up paper, sweep the yard. I will always do that, son. And I would sit in my quiet places. I would cry. I would cry. Because I didn't like having to take her through that. I didn't like it. Well, you were mama's boy. I wish I had been one because I wanted mama to love me. I wanted mama's love. I wanted that. She didn't know how to love. She did not. No more than you without the true love of Yah. You know you love him because you keep his commandments. You know you love him because you asa, you do what he commands you. I don't care how old you are and what you think you are. You will know you love him because you keep the commandments of Yah. Yah is no longer among us because of that spirit of Zana. It prostitutes the counsel of Yah. It defies the counsel of Yah. It has disdain for the love of Yah. It doesn't love the things that Yah loves. It is a murderous spirit that hates and despises those that strive for Yah. A whore always hates a righteous woman. That's what Sirach says. A whore despises the woman that is righteous. When a whore sees a righteous woman, she despises him. That's why this whore Jesus talked, it despises you to talk about Yeshua. The Baptists despise those that talk about Yeshua. Damn their life, Jesus, because everybody loves the name of Jesus. Nobody's, the Catholic Church is not suffering because of the name of Jesus, the Baptist, the Methodist, the Pentecostal. And these damn lying ones that call themselves Hebrews, they're liars. They don't even know Yah.
I want to get into the depths of this. I want to finish this for you, our friends, today, and I shall. The Spirit. It brings death. David gives us a tremendous interlude here in Psalms, Tehillim 73, verse 27. And I want to get into the orchestration of the Spirit. Its birth and how. He says here, for lo, this is what Yah says. He says, man, they are rachach. They're so far removed. They are far from Almighty Yahweh. That's why they are perishing. They are abads. That's why they perish. He says, you have destroyed. Listen to this. He has destroyed all, not some. Psalm 73, 27. You have viciated. You have destroyed all them that go whoring from you. When our minds go whoring from the Torah, he's going to destroy you. We can think, you can set up your own little rosy paradigm and your own filthy self-righteousness of whoredom. He says, all that have gone from Yah, he has destroyed them. Was Yehuda among them that betrayed Yeshua? He was destroyed. He was destroyed. There are those, that's why Yeshua said, let the wheat and the tare tear together. That's all right. You just keep the tear in check. Don't let him get out of hand. Don't let him get up and rebuke nobody. Don't let him get carried away. He's going to destroy them. He's going to destroy them. And someone teach me, I want to know that they got more than I got. Because they're teaching me something that refreshes me. I don't care how simple it sounds. I want to look at them and know that it's all right, that he represents that. That's what I want, oh man. Hallelujah. Why has this been produced among us? Always warn us, the elderly men, they have not guarded the camp. They're clowns and jackasses. I'm talking about men say, well, I heard about this 25 years ago and I was teaching it. It doesn't mean a damn thing. There is no defense for the fence city. We're not defending. We're not defending the body of Yeshua HaMashiach. And when the gates are open to every kind of unclean thing, every kind of unclean thing comes in. So the Nobi, the prophet, he speaks here in the book of Ezekiel, Yeske, chapter 16. This is what Yah says. Because we have not zechar, remember the days of your youth. We don't remember the days of our youthfulness. I always think about that. Ride sometime and it takes me back to 837 Holland Avenue, apartment A. The wind, the fragrance, as a young boy running and playing. I always go back to those days, circumstances. We have not remembered the days of our youthful experience in the way, in the name, in Torah, in truth. We used to sing this song, take me back. Boom, 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 boom. Take me back, boom, 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 where I first, okay, met Yahweh, boom, 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 take me back, Yahweh. So we don't want to go back there.
to the place of our filth. All youth are filthy. No youth know how to obey. They don't know how to keep themselves clean. They must be taunts. They don't know how to do that. Take me back. We have forgot our youth, but hath fretted me. That's what we have done. We have dismissed Yah and all the things that we do. Yah says, behold, therefore, I will repay you, recompense your ways upon your head. What you do, be not deceived. Yah's not mocked. Whatsoever man sow, you're going to reap it. I'm going to repay your own ways upon your own head, says the sovereign Yah. And you shall not commit this lewdness above all your abomination. You act like a whore. You walk like a whore. You have forsaken me. You have azab me. And then you want to add to that. That's what we do. No different than a religious whore. Come before Yah and pretending to. We must let the light, the ma'or, the gladness of the great presence of Yahshua, that must shine in us. And when those that don't know Yah see us, they will ask us, for the reason of the tikvah, why do you have such great inspiration by that? You quack like a duck, you're a damn duck. You walk like a whore, you're a whore. You walk like a whoremonger, you're a whoremonger. Drunken Jezebel, we're drunken with the stench of our own filth. We're drunken with the stench of our own filth. What father does that to their children? They're wicked men that hide things from their children. They never come around them. They're wicked men that even though they didn't even know Yah, there are things they didn't do in the presence of their wives. They kept it from their home. They had boys that they hung out with. They would never bring them to their home. That's a fact of the matter. There were things they were never allowed to come into their home. And we just say that we have Yah, we allow every kind of damn thing to come in. Yah says, it's coming back upon your head, the sovereign Yah, and you shall not commit this lewdness above all your abomination. Why? He says, behold, I want every one of you that understand the mashal, or the usually the proverbs. He said, I want you to use this proverb. I want you all to hear this. Ezekiel 16:44. He said, I want you to speak this proverb against this nation, saying, as is the mother, so is her daughters. As the mother is, she's going to produce that in her daughter because she's not ashamed of her sin. And that's what this religious whore has done to us. We're still birthed. We still have our attachment to it. We still have our attachment to this whore. Her dirty nipple that went into our mouths. So as the mother, even in the natural sense, the mother's a dirty whore. She's going to promote that kind of stuff. And her daughters, I've seen it in my lifetime. I've seen a whore of a mama, and the daughters are worse than the mama. I've seen a whore of a mama say, it's all right. You go out, baby girl. Why you dress up here? Get your boy. You need a man. You are wicked Jezebel. Yeah. You teach them to keep themselves clean and unspotted from the world. That mothers should teach the young daughters to keep themselves unspotted from the world. Keep their minds on Yah. You don't say, well, you got to find out for yourself. No, you should know with experience, you wicked old woman. Yes. And you should tell them, it's wrong, baby. It's wrong. You don't do that. My mother said to me when Yah began to deal with me as a young man, well, baby, Yah knows you're young. Go out and do your thing. And it damn near destroyed me. Every foul thing there is. But I bless Yah, there was a temperament. There was just certain things I would not do. I'm glad. There's just certain things I would not do. I didn't pump no babies out there like other men. They put no babies out there. Not one. There's just certain things I didn't do. I didn't do it. I just didn't do it. I had opportunity to do it, but I didn't do it. No. I didn't do it. As the mother is a whore, and those that call themselves mothers, when they are whorish mothers, they will put whorish concepts in your mind. What are those concepts? You forget, Yah. You will talk about some of the most damnable, foolish things that are so reprehensible before Yah. You talk about things that produce no life. You come into the presence of Yah, there's no gladness. That's the rejoicing. Yeah. There's no shouting before you. There's no dance. You can't do a damn thing. But you can get in the midst of those congregation of idolatry and prostitution, and you're a prostitute. You forget about that. You say things. You want to know about this one and know about that one. You want to ask questions about them that are wicked. You don't ask about ya. What do you require of me, ya? Your dumb fact. That's our minds. Says the mothers of whore that which birth our minds and give us strength, we draw from the nipple of it. That which is brought alive by it, it's going to be a whole. It's going to be a whole spirit. It's going to be a whole spirit. You know, that's why many men I don't really talk to. Just keep it general. I really don't. I've always been that way. Because as in the day, you know, man can measure up another man. It didn't take him long. He knew it's okay. He could measure up a man. He knew what he was about. I can talk with a man 2 minutes. I know what he's about. I can. I measure up a man. All right. Everything's straight with me. When I find some value in a man, I will always try to direct one on that Sadiq path. Well, you're younger than me. You're foolish, old man, though. Silly old man. You think you're wise? No. I don't think I'm wise. I just know the judgment of Yah. That's all. You think you're great? Well, sure, I'm great. That's why I want to serve you all. That's why I want to get up and need to sweep off the thing for your daughter so you slip and fall. Zakane was out there. Well, he's my Zakane too, so I get out there and help him. Make sure you stay warm in your homes and get over there. When my back hurt, I said, well, we got to do something tomorrow, Mama. We just got to split some wood. But I said, take Big Daddy. And we got something on the back side there. He takes that big, bop. We're going to do a little work. Got to. So you stay warm. A baby's going to stay warm. You that want to be great among you, that I will serve them. Hallelujah. Praise Yah. I love him because he first loved me. Yahshua purchased me on that tree at Calvary, and he made me free. I love Yah. I love him because he first loved me. He redeemed my nephews, and he made me free when I was bound to all of my sins. He made me free. And oh, holla, oh, hallelujah! Ah, that's all right. I had old Abner yesterday, boy, we were going. You should have seen him. Never seen him roll like that, boy, he was rolling with me. You know, Mama, we got some snow the day, and I said to the boy, I said, I'm going to take him, and I'm going to put that snow down his back and in his head. He says, no, sir, Papa, you can't outrun me. I don't have to outrun you, son. You're going to obey me when I tell you to come to me, aren't you? Yes, sir. I said, okay. I didn't have to outrun him. I said, come here, boy. My word is my bond. And so I got me a big pile of that snow, and I dropped it in his head and dropped it. And I grabbed him, Mom, and I threw him down. You see, I didn't have to run, did I? Got you. Didn't have to run for it.
I was about to get out there and run after him. He can run all day. Laughing and running and jumping. And he ran, jumped on the trampoline and jumped up on that big tank and said, come get me. And then he slid down the tank and ran around the building. And he ran under the trampoline and playing the snow a little bit. Then he ran and crawled through all these sandboxes up here. I wasn't about to do that. Too cold. Come here, son. So when Yah bids us to come, he's bidding us to come. Now let us enter in, all right? As the mother, so shall the daughter be. As she has carried forth of activities. I will show you her activities. Hallelujah. He begins to define the activities of the spirit. Yes, scale, Ezekiel chapter 23. I want to read from that chapter only. He says, son of man, Adam. He tells him about two women. He says, the daughter of one mother. Do you all hear that? She got two daughters and one mother. She has two daughters, one mother. You have two daughters, one mother. The mother of two daughters. Hear this. It says, and they, the daughters, committed whoredom in Mizraim. You don't give your daughters over to whoredom, to the very frivolous, unfruitful activities of Mizraim, of this mindset of the Coptics, the gods. You don't give them over to that. It says they committed whoredom in their youth because mama taught them to be whores in their youth. We'll show you what they allowed to happen. And this is what we're allowing for our daughters to happen. Their minds being flirted with. Yeah. I don't give a damn if you don't love me. Yeah. There were their breasts, their titties. He said they were mo'ak. They were pressed, squeezed. Somebody handling their titties. They pressing up against a little boy and kissing, and he's touching her titties with his body. Now I'm getting graphic down to the real nitty gritty. We have sucked from every titty but the sincere milk of Torah. She teaches them how to get their titties pressed. Get your boyfriend. Be a part of Mizraim. So her titties are pressed. This is what the book says. This is what Ezekiel 23 says. Her titties were pressed. And then her little titties become bruised. That's what the Torah says. Say what you want to. There's no pleasure, so no husband will be able to enjoy her breasts in the days of her youth. No man, a whorish woman, no man enjoys her breasts. He doesn't enjoy her breasts. The Torah commands us we should enjoy the breastmilk of Yah in the days of our youth. We must remember our youth. You understand? Yes. And so a whorish woman, her breast has no beauty, has no feel, has no life. Yes. Nothing but a flap of titties. I don't care how big she think they are. Yes. Why? Because they bruised her titties, her teats in their virginity, in their birth, Ula. Her titties have been bruised. She's given over unto the internet and every kind of filthy whore shaking her ass. Because mama is ignorant and daddy is ignorant. That's what they give them over unto. I shall, my friend. Because mama is a whore, she teaches them to be whores. She teaches them to dress like a whore. She teaches them to act like a whore. She teaches them to perform like a whore. Because she's a whore. She's an ignorant whore. She can't teach them anything else. And that's what this whore church has done to the nation. We have been trained by a dirty whore. You bring them up in the ways of Yah, even in all of your ignorance. You have done right, they depart, it's on them. You've done right by them. You have shown them by example, your life, the way you live. You owe them nothing, no apology. You owe them no explanation. You don't have to explain one damn thing. Your walk talks for you. The way you carry yourself talks for you. Let them go their way. The titties have been bruised. Their Beth Ula.
And he tells us, and the name of those daughters were, one was named Ahula. I taught on that. This is the metaphoric or the beautiful name of Yerushalayim, that beautiful place where Heshalom. How is it that the city that was full of judgment and the Sadiq of Yah has become a whore? Because of Ahula, hallelujah. Ahula represents Samaria, the northern 10 tribes of Israel. They were sister. He talks about Ahula, that was one by the name of Hola. She was the elderly sister. And Aholaba, which represents metaphorically the city of Shalom, where Shalom is taught. There were two of them. You hear me? And Aholaba, her sister, Yah says, and they were mine. I love them. They were mine. I own them. And they bear sons and daughters. That's where their name, Samaria, which is Ahola, and Yerushalayim, which is Aholaba. It's right there in Torah. Yes, scale 23:4. Hallelujah. Then in verse 5, he says, and Ahola played the harlot. She was a zana. When she was 9, now this is what she did. She began to dote. Her inordinate desire and craving for lust, a whole lust for anything. She began this lust. Her affection was lustful. It was not pure affection that. She began this desire on those lovers, on the Assyrians, her neighbors. It is almost like two being unequally joined together. It's like a daddy saying to his daughter, or oh, well, girl or his son, boy, go out there. She's a fine thing. She make her your girlfriend. That's wicked. And that's what the Assyrians as sure represents. It is a heathen defiled nation that will press on her titties. She will press her lips and her little titties against some boy. That's a fact. And we're pressing you, giving your titties for everyone to suck from it. The wicked, they play in your mind. They play in your breast. And you give yourself over unto that because you are a wicked whore. You have removed your mind from Yah. His judgment doesn't even cause you to fear. You have no fear of Yah. They have lost the fear of Yah from their eyes, from their ayin, from their perspective, their judgment. She gives her titties to be pressed, to be played with. And it's all right. You're wicked, daddy. Mama, you're Jezebel. Daddy, you're homophobic. Even the wicked of daddies will say, no, no, baby girl, you... Wait till you, just wait for school. You get out of school. Wait for that. Mom is nurturing her to be a beautiful young woman, that she will be a Beth Ula virgin. Well, I'm a virgin. No, you're not a virgin. Your titties have been pressed with everything there is. Listen to what Yah says. She played the role of a harlot. She was mine, she a god, she doted. When one dotes, there's an inordinate lust. It cannot be controlled. We can't have enough of this. If you cannot be content with $10, you will not be content with $200. You will not be content with $2,000, $20,000. You will not. Every offering you offer, whether it's $5, $10, it makes no difference. My heart rejoices. You get the same email, the one that sent $10,000. Bless you, my friend. Appreciate it. So much. Great is your gift. Yeah. Dropping down a verse in that same chapter, it says, so she committed whoredom. But what kind of whoredom is this? This is tasnuth, this idolatry. That she worshiped the concepts of her mind. She gave lawful activities of her wickedness to be manifest and carried out. That is tasnuth. That is an idolatry. She allowed those things that were so unlawful against Torah to be enacted upon and carried out with them. With all of them were the chosen men of Assyria, and with all of whom she doted her inordinate. She was a filthy whore. Every man she saw, she would say, oh, that's a fine man. I sure would like to have my hands on him. That's a dog. That's wrong. This is what it says. This is what we... This, Every time we hear some kind of damn crazy concept, we buy it. People send me stuff, I say, don't send me this bullshit thing. Appreciate you thinking about it, but don't send me this bull. 2 minutes, I know what this is about. These men are not of y'all. Don't send me this. If I sat there all day, I can search the damn YouTube and find all kinds of crazy stuff. I don't want to search it for that. And so they went about with the Assyrians doting about with all their idols. She began to torment, she began to defile herself. We cannot be equally joined ourselves. What fellowship with light and darkness? What fellowship do they have? Or with Baal and Yah? You can't have fellowship with that. And so they began to pollute themselves even the more. They began to make themselves unclean and unrighteous before Yah. That's what they began to do. It says this, neither did she leave off her whoredom that she brought from Mizraim. Who reminds us of Mizraim more than Zachem ben Amin? We came out, but we still got the same damn trash in us. You are a whore, you're still a whore. You are a religious pervert, and we're still religious perverts. Still think like you did then. Still act like you act. I don't give a damn if you don't care for me. You have forgotten your whoredom from Mizraim. For in her youth, she shall have, she lay. Yeah, I'm going to lay. Inordinate from her youth, she began to lay with strange men. Pollute her. Make her stinking and worthless. And that's what this spirit of whoredom had made us, stinky and worthless. In her youth, she began to lay. She began to lay with her. And they bruised the breasts, her shad, her titties. She was no virgin. She was a filthy whore in her youth. She was a stinking whore. That's what we are. We commit such whoredom and false rites of passage. We pass ourselves in all of our wickedness because we don't judge ourselves. And she allowed their whoredom to be poured upon them. So when something is poured upon you, you become drenched with it. So what can you do but pour that whoredom out on someone else? That's all you're going to do. This is the older sister, Ahola. This is Samaria. This is Ephraim. This is Israel. This is the 10 tribes, the northern kingdom. They love idolatry. They love every kind of wicked thing. When the mighty hand of Yah brought them out, Yah brought us out. And we go back and look to Mizraim and say, I sure hate that. I miss that. I miss them fun time there, getting drunk and drinking. You are a stupid, stinking Jezebel. That's nothing more vile than a drunken woman. She's a stink of a slut. Nothing. I don't care who you are. That those that call themselves Hebrews, all they do is get drunk. They sit together and they drink and they get drunk. That's wickedness. They smoke dope. That's nothing more vile and vile than a stinking drunken woman. Nothing. She's a dog. She's less than a dog. Her beauty is not expressed in drunk. Well, you don't know. Get on your damn wicked knees and come before you and pray, Jezebel. Judge yourself righteously. That's what you do. And we are filthy whore. We won't judge ourselves. That's right, little Yarabia. That's right. Say hallelujah. She doted about with the Assyrians, her neighbors. She wanted captains. Dirty women look at men and say, oh, he's fine. I want him. Oh, woman, you stink. He doesn't want you. Captains and rulers. And they were clothed with gorgeously, most gorgeously. Oh, he looks so fine. He's gorgeous. That's what they say. You understand? Horsemen riding upon horses. All of them desirable. They were chamet. They were handsome and strong and beautiful. And they knew she was a dog. And the beautiful things of y'all having a quiet and beautiful ruach, we don't want that. Those are the things that are beautiful. Those are the things that we should desire. And she looked at these young men and said, my, my, my. It's almost like me as an old man getting old every day and thinking that because some young woman looks at me as a father, I hope that's how they look at me as a father. I don't play with women. But that I got something that she wants. Maybe your dollars, and I don't have no dollars for no woman. Your dollars, oh silly man. silly old foolish man. You don't even have no physicality that some woman would want. Look at yourself. Come on. Oh, I look at myself when I'm unclothed, so I'm not worrying about that. Let's get real. You can think you're not holding a damn thing but flab and guts and as soft as a baby's butt. Talk to me. Same thing with your woman. Quit. Stop it. You think you got something, you walking like some brook neck chicken, man. Silly old fool. I'm a man. And even if I have to walk like that, just take me on down to the graveyard. You all know, you just let me, put me out there and I'll just rot. Skin worms going to eat me, it won't be long. After a day, that's why you get me in the ground the next day, I start stinking. At the max 2 days. And the skin worms, you're going to rot because our flesh is rotten. Yes. Keep doing what you're doing. Just don't worry. Hallelujah. That's a judgment. That's why he wanted to show us the gravity of his judgment upon the whore, because we have played the role of a whore. We love Mizraim. We love Egypt. We love spending time in Egypt. We love the activities of Egypt. We love the mindset of Egypt, and that's just the truth. And we train our babies to do the same thing. We train them to be inordinate. They don't have affections for Yah. They got affections for a damn car, damn clothing, some damn boy. It's inordinate. It's an inordinate affection. It is not the right affection. We train them to have this great love, this great capacity for all kinds of things, but it doesn't produce a damn thing. We share with them things that at night they press their little teats in the inordinate affection of lust, because you have played the role of a Jezebel. You have not told them little boys doing things that are so inordinate and out of the place of the ram of a young boy. You know it's not of Yah. It's not Yisrael. Hallelujah. You think that stopped them? Torah said, and she increased their whoredom. They get so brazen and so bold, they began to increase their whoredom. The 23rd chapter, verse 17. And the Babylonians came to her into the bed of beloved. We let the system of Babel, this confusion, the lies that we speak to our minds on our beds, we lie down. We lie down with these concepts and lies and Babel, and they defile her with their whoredom. And we defile ourselves. We don't have no love for Yah. And they defile themselves with their whoredom, and she was polluted with them, and her nephesh was alienated from them because they said she is so damn filthy and disgusting. There's nothing more disgusting than a dirty whore. She was disgusting. We're disgusting before Yah. A whoredom that we commit and do. So she discovered her whoredom. And then she, as I said, the nakedness. Not only did she discover her whoredom, young girls discover their whoredom because when they understand their ivra or their nakedness, what nakedness? Their improper behavior, their activities and deeds that are not according to Yah. See, we know when we do things that are improper and wrong. We know that. You know when you're doing something wrong. You know when you're doing your akron, your wrong. You know when you're doing that. You know when you're being mean to them without a cause. You're mean to your wife without a cause. You know you're wrong. You disregard the law, the Torah of your husband, your head, that saves you, woman. You know you're wrong. It's not going to happen in my house. I'm just telling you. I'm the lion. I'm the Eri. I'm the lion there. And there's no doubt about it. I'm the Eri. Hallelujah. She discovered her nakedness, her improper behavior. She was indecent. Then my nephesh, Yah says, and my life was alienated from her, like as my nephesh was alienated from her sister. Ahola, aholaba. Because of her inordinate desire and wickedness, that she wanted every unclean thing. And our minds are inordinate. We want everything that the Torah said, don't touch. Touch not the unclean things of the world. You don't touch them. You don't touch them. That's why you don't lay hands suddenly on no one. I say, I'm just telling you, I see those 11 men. I just don't know. Hold up. No, no. Whoa, now. If a man is a flood of sin, I say, come here, man. How you doing? But those that have defied and turned their heart against you, I just, don't just touch me. I don't let them. You kind. I just don't let them touch me. I don't just embrace them. I'll embrace a winehead, a drunkard that knows not Yah. Them, that affection is wrong. Yet she multiplied her whoredom and calling into remembrance the days of her youth. She said, girl, I'm getting old and you're stinking and you look nasty. You got varicose veins. We have no life substance in our beings. And so you go back to your youth and say, boy, I was a bone daddy, sharp daddy when I was young. You were a silly clown when you were young, man. Wherein she had played the whore in the land of Mizraim, where she was there when Ephraim, there when the whole house of Yehuda was there in Egypt, but they played the role of a whore, and they go back just like old silly man. When he goes back in his age, he's getting old, he go back to his youth, and remember the folly, and he rejoices in that. It shouldn't be that way, mother. You don't go back to your damn juvenile folly, and that gives you strength. You should go back to where he found you. And he brought you out of the depth of the darkness of hell. And your mind was far from him. Take me back to that time when you brought me out of Mizraim. And all of the garbage that was left behind. You go back and think you were nothing but a whore. You laid with every stranger, every boy. And they dogged you and they didn't give a damn about you. And that's our problem. Lay with every kind of strange God. Every kind of damn Jesus. The Baptist Jesus. The Methodist Jesus. The white Jesus. The black Jesus. It's going to take this kind of truth to get us right. You think you'll get right with some kind of serenading? It's not going to happen. Hallelujah. She goes back to her youth where she remembered her wickedness. And she said, oh, I was a fine thing. We're not fine. There's no tough thing in our flesh. We're just like that grass. We're going to die. Don't be a jackass of a fool. You're going to die, fool. Hallelujah. To expedite verse 27. Yah says, in this manner would I make your zimah, your luteness. Yeskel 23:27. Yah tells us in the manner he's going to make your zimah, your wicked devices, your little plan. You know how you plant things on your bed at night? You know they're wicked. You're going to get up. You're going to do your thing. You have this mischievous purpose and you know it's wicked. You know it's wrong. We defy our husband, man. We defy Yahshua. Well, I know it's wrong to do, but I'm going to do it. You don't understand. You are wicked, man. You're a wicked woman. You know you're wicked. You're filthy as hell. Not too many can stay long with me. The young ones, sometimes their wives say, well, they got time to go to everywhere. They can go to Walmart 20 miles away. We go to Walmart, it's 26 miles to this Walmart. We have no problem going to Walmart. We have no problem with that. But when it comes time to Yah's place to be bathed and washed, we got a problem with it. He washes in this pure water. Well, your words are not pure. I speak the Tahor, the pure words of Yah. Hallelujah. Yah says, in this manner will I make your lewdness to cease from you. He said, you're going to stop. How are you going to stop me, Yah? He says, and your whoredom brought from the land of Mizraim to stop. I'm going to make it stop. So that you should not lift up your eyes to them, nor choose to remember Mizraim anymore. He said, I'm going to stop it. How is he going to do that? Well, we'll find out how he's going to do it. But you don't take no delight in what you did in Mizraim. You don't take no rejoicing. You're ashamed of all the things you've done. You redeem the time. You sow into your sons and your daughters the beauty of your motherhood, your strength. Man, you sow into the sons of Israel your beautiful strength, your character. That's what you do. He says that you're not going to remember that anymore. For this says the Sovereign Almighty Yah. Yah says, behold, I want you to understand.
I'm going to deliver, I'm going to nothen, I'm going to bestow, I'm going to give you into the hands of them that hate you. Those that are your enemies, I'm going to give you into their hands. Those that shone, those that you are bona fide enemies against. Who shall be a man's own foe? A man's foe shall be of his own house. You are the foe in your own house, mama, daddy. You're the foe in your own house. You don't give your sons and daughters, you don't give your children, your grandchildren, the pattern of the strength of a beautiful man. Mama, you don't show them the strength and the beauty of a mother. You defy the order of Yah. I'm talking all you wicked, hard-headed women and you effeminate, weak boys that call yourself men and husbands. You don't know a damn thing about love. You don't even know what love is. He says, into the hand of them from whom your nephesh, from whom your life has been alienated or nahach. You have estranged yourself from them. Yah said, I'm going to give you over to them. And that's what he is doing. Because of our whoredom, he's given us back over to that. You're doing things that those doing things and thinking on things that they didn't even when they were in Mizraim, they didn't even think on it. That those we are doing things that, and we're captivated by things that we've never done, Yisrael. And yes, I'm giving you back over to it. You rejoice in that I'm giving you back over to those vile spirits for one reason. I'm going to wreak havoc on your wicked hearts. His judgment is true and just. It's a righteous judgment. And they shall deal with you hatefully. But they love me. Your mammy doesn't give a damn about your grandmammy, your cousins, your sisters, and your brothers. That's a fact. They will deal with you hatefully and shall take away your strength, your labor, and shall leave you naked and bare. You leave from their presence, you feel naked. You don't have no strength. You don't feel like nobody's on your side. You don't feel like you have nobody because that's where you made your abode. They shall make you avrah. They shall make you naked, that even your affections are distorted. He says, and the nakedness of your whoredom shall be discovered, both your lewdness and your whoredom. He's going to find you out. That which is done in the secret is going to be held from the mountaintop. But don't tell nobody my business. A whore is a whore. You don't have to tell nobody your business. Your business spread of what you are. Your look, your attitude. You don't have to tell nobody my business. I have no business. It's filthy. Hallelujah. Yah says, and I will do these things to you because you have gone a-whoring after the Kareem, after the heathens. And because you are polluted with your own idols, your idolatry, your own wickedness, your own vileness, your corruption. You have polluted yourself with these activities. Every house. All 12 tribes. Yerushalayim is the spirit of Sodom and Egypt today. Yah gave us a vast quantity of land from the great river of Mizraim, the Nile River, unto the great river of Euphrates. I will teach that soon. Then the strip of land cannot support 50 million people, 100 million. But the breadth of his land will do more than that. This is the large nation we live in. And the vast majority of this land is uncultivated. You understand? Over 300 million people here. And they live in the major metroplex. We've forgotten how to grow and to make ourselves healthy. That's why we are in the shape that we're in. Hallelujah. Yah says, you've gone a-whoring. He says unto them both, you have walked a-cholaba, Yerushalayim. You have walked in the ways of your sister. Therefore will I give her cup into your hand. You want to walk like a duck and quack like one? I'm going to make sure you die like a duck. The same cup that a-chola, you shall drink from that same cup, a-cholaba. You have done the very same thing. That's why we must train our children. You train them in the way right. All that you know what is right to do, you train them. And when they are all of they go away, you have done the righteous thing. You don't come under the subjugation of their mocking or saying that you didn't do right by me. No, you did right by them. My mother did right by me. And all of her ignorance, she did right by me.
She did right. She tried to bring me up right. She tried to show me what was right, even in all of her ignorance. That's why I say to her, Mom, I'm glad you wore my backside out. She didn't do that to the other ones. She did it to me. And I'm glad. I'm not dysfunctional. I'm not some damn pedophile. That's a fact. I'm not going to mistreat the babies. And I'm not going to put myself in a position to be with your babies either. How about that? All right. Yah says this to this woman. He says, you shall be filled with shikharun. What is that? In verse 33, you shall be filled with drunkenness. You shall be intoxicated with self. You shall be intoxicated with the wines. That's what he's telling Achulabach. You shall be drunk. It's almost like a mother leaving home and she goes and drinks with those in Mizraim and forget about her babies and little babies, arm babies, and she forget about them. And she goes and shows herself as a damn harlot and a fool. She sells herself like a 2-cent whore. You can get mad at me. I don't mind folks getting mad at me. I get mad at me. Mama, I get mad at me all the time. I get angry with me. And I talk to me. I will never talk to you like I talk to me. Yah says, you're a dirty whore. And you will know she's a dirty whore. Yah says, I'm going to fill you with shikharun. You shall be intoxicated. The yayin, the wines. Not only will I fill you with that, but there shall be great yachun, great sorrows. Now these are the four things. Listen to them. He's going to fill you with drunkenness. Yachun, you're going to be in such anguish of displeasure. He's also going to feed you with the cup of shema, of astonishment. You're going to be astounded. You're going to be a wasteful one. Your mind will be wasteful. Your thoughts and your ways. You will be an appalling thing to look upon. And then he also says, I'm going to fill you with desolation. Shemama, you shall be nothing. You shall be left to a waste. Your mind shall be wasted. It will produce nothing. It will produce no life, anything. He says, with the cup with your sister, Samaria, Ahola. Ahulaba. Yah says, you shall even drink it. You shall drink it, and it shall spew out of you. So you will know if there's a cesspool, a filthiness, and it's spewing out, you know it's a cesspool right there. You know what's spewing out of your mind. He says you're going to drink it, it's going to drain out of you. So when you put something in you, it comes out. What goes in got to come out. What goes in got to come out. And it's going to drain, and it's going to drain out, and you shall break even your earthenware or your body, the house of Yah, your earthenware, your clay pottery, it shall be broken thereof. And he says, then you're going to pluck off your titties, your breasts. You're going to beat your breasts as one that is mad. As Eyob says, cursed be the paps that I even laid my mouth upon to suck. No blessing. They're going to pull their breasts off. Why? Yah says, for I have spoken it, and I am the mighty one. That's why. What is all of this? What is the result? Can I read the next verse? Yah says, Yeskel 23:35. Therefore, thus says Yah, the sovereign ruler, the master, because you have forgotten. We forget Yah. You have forgotten me and cast me behind your back. You got to be a whore to cast off Yah and the Torah, and that you go beyond that and you do what you want to do. You got to be a whore among a man to cast off your love relationship with your wife and to see other women and think that you're appealing and you want to be appealing to them. You got to be a cheap whore woman to cast off your first love or to cast off the one you love.
You got to be a cheap whore. You got to be a dollar whore. And we have sold Yah for an inordinate affection. Yah said, you have cast me behind your back. He says, therefore, bear. You're going to have to bear this. Your own burden. You bear. You also your lewdness and your whoredom. A nation that was full of judgment and righteousness. How did they forget? Because of whoredom. That's why we forget the judgment of Yah, our own whoredom. We have an infatuation with ourselves. We have an infatuation. That's a fact. We cast Yah behind our backs, but Yah say, that's all right. Not only your whoredom, but your lewdness and all of your filthiness, all that's coming. Verse 43 of the same chapter. Then I said, why is this going to happen? Then I said to her, this is Yah, that was worn out by adultery. You see, they say, that woman is a worn out whore. In my days, they would say that. She's a worn out whore. That old man ain't worth a nickel. He just wore out. Ain't nothing but a whole manga. I would hear the older people say that. Yah says you are a worn out whore. You can't tell a worn out pair of shoes from a new pair. I'm a brand new me. Just because of your shoe. I like that song. He says again, then I said to her. He's talking to her. Listen. He says, that was worn out by your whoredom. People would say that's a woe out old whore. She's been through every meal there is. Come on, you might as well be honest. She's a worn out old nasty looking hoe. And every man that will see her say, but that hoe is worn out. Who wants her? Who wants that old worn out hoe monger? He ain't worth a dime. We are a worn out whore. That's going to be one thing that restores us. We must have true judgment and justice among us as a nation. This is important. We must have the shafat, men that are able to judge without resistance, and they're not afraid because they're spiritual. I'm not talking about some little fancy pants, two wooden nickels of a boy. So self-absorbed and so into me. There's nothing about you that you should be into. I'm into truth. How about that? Then I said to her that was worn out by her damn whoredom, a worn out whore that looks nasty, dirty fingernails and dirty damn toenails. How about that? Her feet are dirty. She stinks. Her spiritual house stinks because her natural house stinks. Worn out. Will they now commit whoring with her? And she with him, she's a worn out whore. Her mind is so full of whoredom. Yah says, are they the Assyrians and those of Mizraim going to, who wants that piece of trash? Who wants that dog? Yet, they still went into her. A hoe is a hoe. They went into her. And as they go into a woman that plays the harlot. So they went into a chola and a cholaba. They were lewd women. They know that she's a piece of trash. They know that that's why people can put anything in our minds or say anything to us and we buy it. I don't give this world room to even play with me. My conversation with the world is very limited in the sense that I don't laugh with them. You won't find me laughing with those in the world. You know, you really won't. I see people, see those that I haven't seen in years. You don't find me. Some men think that, you know, that's normal. But it's not normal. That's silly. Yeah. We're not in a time to laugh. When you hear things, it's a time to weep with great sorrows. Listen to this. Ezekiel 23:45. This is the command of Yah. I'm going to conclude with a few verses. It says, and the righteous men. Ezekiel 23:45. And the righteous men, they shall shofat. They shall judge them. We that are righteous men, we shall judge them. How? After the manner of an adulteress as a whore. That's how you judge them. And you tell them you're a dirty whore. That's how you judge this whore, this adulterous woman.
righteous men. Not weak boys, but righteous men.
They shall judge them after the manner of adulterous whore, and after the manner of a woman that shed blood, because they are adulterous, and the blood, the sin, is in their hand. You just don't watch out the sin. There are women that even their physical attributes are dirty and it stinks, and you don't see the beauty of that. That's just a fact. When I take a bath, first thing I do, I got brushes. I keep me a little brush, and I keep my nails all the way down, to, as Granny would say, down to the quick. And the first thing I do when I go in the bath, I brush my nails. I get them out, and I take clippers, and I clip everything. I can't stand dirty nails. The first thing I do, before I do anything, I wash them, before I wash my face.
Lift up your clean hands to here for the nation of Israel.
If I'm not attentive to my hands, then I can't lift up clean hands. So my hands must be clean. I keep my hands clean. You understand? They're clean. And I keep my nails clean. There are women that even their hands are filthy because of sin, and they don't realize it. The touch is not even human. The men that touch is not even human. The embracing is not even pleasurable. And that's just the truth. But the righteous men shall judge. That's why he that is spiritual judge all things. And he's judging no man. When a man that is spiritual, he judged something, you're not going to have too much gangs here. They're afraid to hit on him. But a clown, they will deal with a clown. Hallelujah. For us, nation, as a people, there is something vital for us, and Yochanan speaks it in Gilead Revelation, chapter 22. This is the great blessing. This is the great riches of our knowing our place, and we know we love Yah. Revelation 22:14, he says, Baruch Barach Adei, that do his mitzvah, his commandments. You keep the commandments of Yah, and they may have right to the knowledge of Yahshua HaMashiach, to the tree of life, and that they may enter into the gates of the city. What city? The city Yerushalayim, the city whereby is full of judgment. When you keep the commandments, you will always go into true Yerushalayim, city full of judgment, and city that is full of the Sadiq of Yah. We go into the cities that we have created by our own inordinate affection and our lust, and we gather in cities. Drunkards gather with drunkards. Drunkards don't gather with crackheads. Crackheads don't gather with drunkards. That's just a fact. Hustlers gather with hustlers. Prostitutes gather with prostitutes. Drunkards like drunkards. He says, we have right to the tree of life, enter to the gates of Yah. He says, I want to tell you, for without are dogs. You hear that? There are no dogs. Not ak or dusty. Nah. What is a dog? Shirak tells us what a dog is. Shirak 25:26. A shameless woman. She's not ashamed of what she does. And this assembly is not ashamed of what it does. It's not ashamed of what it does. A shameless woman should be counted as a dog. When a woman has no shame. There was a day in my life that I could see when women, they were ashamed to do things that were inordinate. They will hide themselves from the public. That's a fact. They will hide themselves. And there are women that messed up one time in their life. They have never regressed back to that. They've never regressed back to that. There are women that have messed up and they have found husbands because of the light of their beauty. That's why. But a shameless woman that doesn't give a damn, she's not ashamed. She is to be counted as a damn dog. And that dog is not going into the kingdom. That dog will never, I don't give a damn. She can shout all day until her drawers drop. She's not going into the kingdom knowledge. She's a drunkard, Jezebel. She will never be filled with the wisdom of Yah. Rehab, she obeyed those spies. She did. She did not go back and say, I got to go. She said, I get in the house, for the storm is coming. You better get in this house, for the storm is coming, and death is all around us. That's what she did. She brought a man. It's time for the mothering spirit of Yisrael to bring in. A shameless woman that has no shame of her ways. She's to be counted as a damn dog. That's what Torah says. But she that is shamefaced will fear Yah. When a woman is shame, when she knows she has brought Yah to the ultimate
ultimate shame because she hasn't judged herself. She will be so shameless that she won't do it again. There are things in life, I was wicked, my friend. But there was times I prayed, y'all, I didn't even know y'all. I said, God, if you get me out of this, I will never, boy, there are things I've never done again. It was horrific and horrifying. It feared me. You hear that? Sirach 26:25. A shameless, a woman without shame, she is to be counted as dog. That's why he said that no dog without are dogs and sorceress in Revelation. She's to be counted as a dog, but a woman that is shamefaced. She's not out watching men. She's not out watching boys. She's not out talking like a damn fool. Man coming to, I see that all the time with women. I see it all. I'm telling you. I see it. I see women that are very shameful. And they're very intimidating. They're very fearful. You understand? Why? Because when they see something that is honest, with honest and decent, when they see a cat that they know that he's trying to, he ain't about a damn, they're not shamefaced. But when they see a man that they got the sense that there's decency about him, I see it all the time. I see women speak to me, and I know they're shamefaced. I say, how you doing, ma'am? And I keep about my business. And then there are those that they're bold and brazen as a dog. And when women see that beauty and the strength of a man, it's not for something for an inordinate affection. It's not for that, Yisraya. And when you find a shamefaced woman, she is one that fears Yah. She fears, she keeps the mitzvah. She's blessed of Yah. She obeyed the commandments of Yah. Her conversation is ordered right from the Torah. She doesn't speak her damn stupid, empty, immature mind like we do. She speaks according to the Torah of her head. She listens. She doesn't understand things. She waits for the answer. She's quiet, not like this Jezebel spirit today. Listen to this, a modest and shame-faced and faithful wife. She adds virtue. I don't care if the man is a drunkard. You've been with me a long time, daughter. You've been with me since day one. And I will always say, I don't give a damn if your daddy, the man, is a drunkard. You come home and find him pukey puke. You still honor him. You don't have to go that way, but you honor him. And when a woman is shamefaced, she loves you. I don't give a damn what the state of the man is. She can bring him out of that. That's why she's a helpmeet. Because she adds high heels. She adds virtue to virtue. She adds strength and power and might. He sees her beauty. It corrects him. It makes him get up in the morning. She's a damn dog. Dogs lay around and wallow and sleep. She's a damn dog. He'll do the same thing. Yeshua is not a dog. He's not a damn God. You wallow with the dogs, you're going to get fleas. That's what a shame-facing woman does. She's at virtue. We become a shame-facing woman. We will add virtue to virtue. And her contented, her mind of shalom, and her chaste nephesh cannot be valued. When you find a woman, who doesn't want a wife like that? Send him a strong one, yeah. Send down your beautiful ring. Oh, yeah. Do it, yeah. Yeshua's mighty name, and we shall rejoice with him. We shall dance and sing with him. You young ones, you add virtue to virtue. You add strength and character every day. And be shamefaced. You don't need a boyfriend, any of you young ones. You don't need to like nobody. You keep that under control. You can watch the youngest. They can't get away from you. You understand? Hallelujah. But that's what a shamefaced woman does. And her pure contentment, if we are contented, having food in your raiment, that will be content. I don't give a damn if you don't have electricity, be contented. There are many days we didn't have no electricity. We got so slick, Zakin, that my brothers, you know, in the old days, they would just come and put those little rubber caps on the meat and shut you down. Well, they would come check at an inopportune time, so you got your lights back, because my brother, they go back there and jam it back up. You can't do that today. They shut it down from, boom, it's off. They don't come and check no meters. It's off. When they shut it down today, it's off. So my brothers, they go out there and we didn't have no electricity. The water turned off. They would turn the water back on. They would come out and then they would take the meter. But they were slick. Brothers get on there, find a piece of pipe, put a pipe between them, turn, whoom, we got water. They would come and take the meter and lock that box down. Them cats were so slick, they said, always watch out during the day. Now when you're at home, don't turn those lights on. My natural brother, Wesley, he was a thief as there is a thief. He could do all that kind of stuff. He'd go out there and fabricate him a little metal crossover for that thing, and he hit that thing, bam, and we got electricity. True? That's what they did. That's right. Boom. We had electricity. Mama didn't have no money. Mama made $35. She would bring home $32.50 a week. I didn't want to put no burden on her. She didn't have no money. Our rent was $15 a week. And I would hustle, make money. And I would, in that hour, I was proud to give her them $3. That was a lot of money back then in the 60s. You could eat on that a couple of days, Mama. Talk to me. You get a cabbage, get two chickens, get some rice, get some flour, get some sugar, get some biscuits, and talk to me, and then you can get some Kool-Aid. No, I didn't get no three pieces of chicken. I got one piece. I got the back. All right. I got the back. I didn't get no drum. Ronnie, I can get, come on, you all. I can get three or four wings if I want to. Get five. No, one hamburger. Who wants one hamburger? I was a kid. We had a cooking hamburgers. You savor the hamburger because you need to get but one. And if you got a hot dog with a hamburger, that's right. You're happy. So you had all the trimmings around that hamburger, and you want everybody to eat there so you can savor yours and just look at me. I'm eating this hamburger. That's the way you did it. And even though my mother had no husband, I appreciated my mother. And even though she did indecent things, she tried to make sure with all of her ability. She wasn't out hoeing. She wasn't out. She didn't leave us at home. My mother didn't go out and party all. Very seldom she would. She didn't do that. She was home with us. She was home with us. She wasn't out every weekend. That's just a fact. She was home with us. She was home with us. Oh, she would get together and they would go out with the girls on Friday, but she wasn't out. No, no. She was home with us. She was home. Don't worry about what time it is. It's Yah's day. We on His time. And she would make sure that we had. She did. And we didn't have a daddy. There are things that she missed out on because she was ignorant. She was just an ignorant woman. Her mama didn't teach anything. So she didn't know how to teach my sister the beauty of a woman. I think my sister was 19 years old when she had her first baby. She's 60 years old. She has a son that's about 41, 42 years old. So that's all she was when she had her first baby. And all her sons are grown men, boys. And of course they got babies. She called me, oh, he got 8 or 9 young'uns. She got one son, got 8 young'uns, I believe. And they're all biracial little children, all by white gals, all of them. All of them. All of them. They're 5 by 1. 2 by 1, 2 by 1. He's in the prison. He said, you come visit. I'm not going. I wouldn't even go down to the prison because he's there. Right down here in Bennettsville. I'm not going down there. We got open door policy there. He doesn't even, if I walked in there today, he wouldn't know what I look like. Let me close with this last one. So we need precious daughters that represent the assembly. And the only way you're going to get that way, there must be correction. There's nothing correct me more than a faithful man. His walk corrects me. His attitude corrects me. His faithfulness. There's no need for him to sin. Just because he's a faithful man and an honest man, it corrects me. Listen. It talks about a woman that the shamefacedness. If we are ashamed, we're not trying to be promote ourselves. Shirach says 41:24. 41:24. Read it. He says,
so shall you be truly shamefaced. And then when you're shamefaced, you will find favor. You will find favor before all men. All men will honor you. When you're shamefaced, when I was in school, the girl that was shamefaced, she was honored. And those that were not shamefaced, they were dishonored. And every boy talked under their garments. But the one that was shamefaced, she was honored. So when you're shamefaced, we as a woman that's shamefaced, how do you become shamefaced? We receive judgment. We judge ourselves. We receive judgment. That shamefaced girl, that mama would always judge her ways and her dress and her attitude. And she would allow that to fill her mind. And because she allowed that, she was honored by all men. The boys would not try to ravish her, oppress her breasts. They honored her. There's one that was loud and crazy and silly that they had no honor for. And that's just the truth. It was the ones that were bodacious and the ones that act like a dog. And they, boy, she's a dog, boy, that's a dirty dog. And that's what they will call them. So a woman that is not shamefaced, she's counted as a dog. And no dog going into the kingdom. Y'all's not going to even judge a dog. So you women, you men, you better get it right. You may not be a dog, man, but you are a sorcerer. You are a liar. No liar. All liars shall have their part. You are a liar. You are a conniving liar. And the way we overcome that, the way we combat that, the way we have victory over that is by judging. That's why judgment is so important. And we ought to embrace those that judge us. We ought to love them that tell us the truth. And reject those that flatter us with lies. Oh, brother, you got great knowledge. No, you don't have no knowledge, man. You don't even have no knowledge of the Torah. You can't even go on that find out what you were talking about. You can tell me you read something like that. Tell me what book it was in. Tell me what was produced out. You can't even tell me that. Help us, you can tell me the website you went to. It is right, man. You don't have to love me. Come on, Zaki. I don't care if men don't love me. Do I upset you sometime, Rafael? Okay, good. You love me? Okay, I believe that one. Shalom. I greet you all.
Todiyah, hallelujah. Barak Yahweh for another day. He has given us Yisrayah, beautiful day. We have been fed well in the Ruach. You know, if a message that we have heard today trouble us, and it should trouble us, but it should cause us to shoo that we do what is siddiq, what is right. But if this message caused you to turn and caused you to rebel, then woe unto your nefesh. Woe unto you. So it's paramount that we take heed, that we shemak, and that we hear. And when you truly hear, you will obey and you will do Yisrayah. And in that you will find the strength of Almighty Yahweh in your bosom, that you will press on, that you'll be even more willing to do what he charges us to do, Yisrayah. And he doesn't ask much of us, hallelujah, but just to obey his mishpat, his Torah. Let us stand to our feet, hallelujah. As we dismiss, we do barak all y'all that listen by via live stream, that listen to the broadcast station, and we pray that the shalom of Almighty Yahweh will overwhelm all of Yisrayah, hallelujah, that we rest on this day in Yahshua HaMashiach. Almighty Yahweh, we do barak you for another day you have made. You have given us life. You have given us breath. You have given us Yahshua HaMashiach. And we do total you, Abba Yahweh, for all things that you have done, Abba Yahweh, for every action, for every trial, for every situation. And Almighty Yahweh, just for your hasi, your hasid, Abba Yahweh, that you pour out unto Kol Yisrayah. And all things we do barak you, take those that have come from near and far home safely. And again, that your Melekim, that your Malak, and that your Torah will be encamped around us, Abba Yahweh, to protect us from the ways and the wiles of the enemy. And all things we do, barak you, in Yahshua's precious name we do pray. Hallelujah. 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 Yahweh. Hallelujah. Yabarak Kol Yisrael. Shabbat Shalom.